at one point in my life, I couldn't move, meaning that I was paralyzed. And that came from a horrible accident as a child at the age of 12. And this was the summer before going to junior high school or middle school. I had a terrible bike accident, and the doctors told me I'd never be able to walk again. But there was, believe it or not, one ray of hope out of all these people. And that was an uncle of mine who would come over and visit. And what was interesting about him is that this was my Uncle Thomas. He came to me, and there was nobody else around. And he said, "Nephew, are you just going to lay there forever?" And I said, "Well, I can't walk." And then he said, "Do you want to walk again?" I said, "Yeah, but I can't." He said, "I'm just asking you, if you do want to walk again, I'm going to help you." He brought by an ottoman, a footrest, that had four wheels. So he asked me to turn on my side because I had upper body strength, and I did. And he said, "Flip over again," which put me on my stomach. And then he said, "I need you to slide off of the bed, stomach down, of course, face down, onto this ottoman with four wheels," of which I was able to do, and he gave me a little bit of help. And the next thing you know, I was able to go down the hall. I was able to go into the living room. I was able to travel into the den, into the kitchen area, into everybody's bedrooms. Then I was able to transfer to a regular chair, which is a little bit more sturdy and a little bit more rigid, but I was able to go from the chair. So now from the couch, then I was able to go to the chair, and then the next thing I was able to do was move that chair close to a wall, because now I really believe that if I could get up off the chair and use my legs, if I had any kind of strength, I could stand. Weeks had gone by practicing once again to body home, and finally, after getting the upper body strength and the legs going, I was able to one day finally push up, and ever weak as I was, but I was able to finally move up, stretch, and there I was up, and now I was standing. Next thing I knew, I was on the football team in high school and played a defensive position, a defensive tackle, and that worked out pretty good. Graduated from high school, went to college, and graduated with a degree in television and motion picture production from UCLA. And from that, I was able to use that those skills and abilities to work in the Hollywood movie industry. So all those things that would have never been there if it had not been for somebody who really knew, different than anybody else, this would have never happened, but it did, and it was great. I was able to take the ball and literally run with it. Several years ago, about 2009, 2010, I became a high school inclusion teacher at Eastside Memorial High School here in Austin, Texas. The school paired me with another young man, wasn't in a wheelchair, but he was on a walker. The doctors and the team of physicians and everyone else had told him that he was always going to be on the walker. And because he had had brain surgery, which was the reason for the walker, it affected his vision, his hearing, his walking, his whole system was affected from the brain surgery.
What did they tell your parents about
you? They told us to I'm not going to get no more.
Nothing?
No, to live no more.
That you were going to die?
Mm-hmm.
I got the feeling that from listening to him that he was depressed because he had been told those words that life would never change for him, and he would always be stuck on a walker, and there was nothing that could be done for him. So one day, as he was talking about this, I said, well, let me ask you something. What do you want? Do you want to get better? Do you want to one day get rid of that walker and be hands-free? He said, yes, but it'll never happen because the doctor said, I'm always going to be like this. And I asked him one more time, do you want to get better and at least try, and I can help you? I began to modify my relationship with him, and I had to work in different at different points, where I was a friend, where I was a mentor, a coach. I was someone trying. I was also using myself as a role model, and then I started using phrases that I thought would make a difference in his life. I told him that. Every man decides for himself, makes his own decisions about his own life and what he wants, and he needed to take control of that. I also told him that it's your world. And I went to him one day and I said, Gustavo, the lunch bell, we need to go to the cafeteria and eat. And he said, no, I'm not interested. I don't want to eat today. I said, well, we're going to eat because the nurse said you must, and obviously you need food. And he repeated himself three or four times, no, no, and no. And then I said, so let me ask you something. What is the problem? He said, I don't have any problems. He said, you were the one that told me I need to start thinking for myself. I said, well, I may have said that. He said, no, you told me to start thinking for myself. And then you told me I need to take control. I said, okay, I may have. He said, you know you did. And then you told me that it's my world, right? I said, yeah. I said, okay, I said all those things. So what are you trying to tell me? He said, well, I'm just letting you know. I'm a new man now. I'm the champion.
I wanna have my family. Want a job.
Is there a certain kind of job that you want to do?
I want to do mechanic.